what I would like to do is walk you some of my interests in this area of how you can engineer biomaterials and controlling them in such a way that they can provide external information to living cells and being used to coax them to elicit desired functions, and some in this broader area of regenerative medicine. So I'll start and I'll give some background, and I've tried to keep some of the discussion at a higher level to explain some of the challenges and some of the advancements that we've made in this field. But before I go into that, I just wanted to first start with acknowledgments. Everything that I'll tell you about today is a result of interactions with students, postdoctoral associates, collaborators, and I know there are many of those in the audience today, and I'm the first to acknowledge the pleasure of being able to interact with and train the next generation who's going to tackle all the problems that I'll tell you about today. So there's a list of their names, and then our scientific collaborators that have participated in various aspects of this research. All right, so let me begin. So I decided to pull up this article to set the stage. I know you can't read the details of this, but this was an article published in the Journal of the American Medical Association. And it came out right when we were nearing our entrance into the new millennium. We're coming into the year 2000. And the premise of this was an article where they talk about the millennial child. So all the babies that were going to be born, what was their life going to be like? And it's sort of a fun article, and if I just blow up a little section of this here. So now the year is 2150, and this patient is coming in to the hospital, and she's a 150-year-old female, talking about her past medical history, with heart disease, leukemia that was solved by a bone marrow transplant. 75 years ago, she had her diabetes that led to renal failure. And the article goes on, and really it's speculating about how we may overcome diseases, solve diseases, or improve quality of life. And so this is some of the patient's past surgical history. And one that I like is this bilateral knee replacements 47 years ago, and then a femoral head excision, so they're cutting off her hip joint, and they're regrowing it by an osteophyte stimulating factor for arthritis of her left hip 35 years ago. So this gets at the context of how we might begin to think about going from replacement medical devices. So as Buddy talked about, improving integration and interfaces of those devices with our body, to what does the future hold with our capability to get the body to heal itself when processes go awry. And so some of this may be very far-fetched, but some of these we already know exist today. So in the perspective of thinking about the building blocks in our body, so our body is composed of about a trillion different cells, and those cells are responsible for growth, for healing, for maintaining us throughout our lives. And sometimes that one component is delivered back to us to help save our lives. Blood transfusions have been around for a long time. Bone marrow transplants are used to treat patients that have certain cancers, in some case putting them into remission. Islet transplantations, there's the Edmonton protocol where they will take islets and the insulin secreting cells in the islets, and they'll isolate those from the pancreas of about three donors. And they'll transplant those into patients who are having a very difficult time maintaining their blood glucose levels. Now those patients have to be on immunosuppression, so they're already fairly sick, but it's a life-saving procedure. Another one that I'll talk a little bit more in detail is autologous chondrocyte implantation. Using your own cartilage cells, injecting them back into your joint with the hopes of trying to regrow cartilaginous tissue. And in fact, if you go to the FDA website and you do a search on even just different stem cell-based therapies and clinical trials, you get tens of thousands of hits of how different progenitor cells and stem cell populations are being used as therapies, injected into hearts after a heart attack with the hopes of trying to reduce damage or repair damaged muscle in your heart. Delivering different cell populations back into the brain to try to alleviate debilitating consequences of neurodegenerative diseases such as Parkinson's disease. There are even beginning to emerge different types of trials where we're using iPS, induced pluripotent stem cells, and embryonic stem cells, and the ability to differentiate them into many specialized cell types, such as oligodendrocytes that were being pursued to try to repair spinal cord injuries. Now, while this is growing, and I think we'll see more and more increases in our lifetime, some of the issues are that oftentimes these treatments are suboptimal, because sometimes when you just inject the cells are lacking some cues and they may not integrate as well or they may not survive. Sometimes it's called engraftment. And oftentimes, if only 1 to 5% of the cells survive, that's considered a good strategy, and those few cells that survive can have a therapeutic effect. But from a material science or materials chemistry perspective, you know, the building blocks of our bodies are cells that reside in a niche, in a tissue environment, in an extracellular environment that one might consider as equally important in a cell-based therapy, that you may need to deliver along with the cells important information that surrounds that cell and gives them just enough that you can improve or coax those cells to have the desired or intended function. So we're very interested in how one can design different types of biomaterial scaffolds and the chemistry behind that and the processing behind that and controlling this at multiple size scales. So one way that you could envision this just pictorially is if you have a cell, what we're interested in is assembling around that cell a scaffolding material structure that can provide signals. And those signals might be the cell's ability to bind to that environment, to interact with another cell, or to interrogate or receive a growth factor or a protein signal. And one aspect of the field is very interested in embedding cells in three dimensions in such a manner that the cells receive just enough information that it coaxes them to regenerate tissue structures. And here on the right, I'm showing a picture of cartilaginous tissue, which will go in as one specific example. But can we regrow cartilage and resurface joints rather than replacing them with implants? But oftentimes, one of the trickiest parts about this are knowing which signals to introduce to the cells and how to introduce them in the right context at the right time and in the right place. And the field needs to learn a lot about that as well. While cells have a tremendous capacity to proliferate and to regenerate, sometimes you need to know more about external, internal signaling and exchange. And so that also brings one into the space of trying to understand basic fundamental biological questions. So when you're expanding a stem cell population or you want to differentiate it down a certain pathway, how can I take advantage of material niches to do that? All right. So in this context then, just by way of a little bit of background then, so cells can get many signals from their material environment. So they will bind in specific ways with proteins in the extracellular matrix. And the cells have these integrins on their surfaces and a whole suite of different integrins that interact specifically with different adhesion proteins found in this space. So depending upon your cell type of interest. There are also many cell-cell interactions that are very important. And cells communicate with one another through functional junctions that they form with one another. We've also learned a lot in the past decade that it's not just about the chemical factors that a cell receives, but also the context of the physical environment and the mechanical environment, because cells are not only binding within this environment, they're forming active actin filaments and stress fibers that pull on this, and many of these receptors are also mechanically sensitive. So cells are also sensing their surrounding material environment from a mechanical perspective. Now, all these factors then combine and they'll influence many cell functions. They influence how a cell moves, and motility migration is very important in wound healing. It'll influence how a cell interacts with that matrix and whether it gets perhaps a survival cue. Fate decisions of a cell, is it going to apoptose or is it going to proliferate and expand? And if I'm in a stem cell niche in your bone marrow, for example, I'll also get signals that might tell me that I need to migrate and differentiate and go into a repair mode. So it's from this perspective then, all these processes though act on many different size and time scales. And that's where a lot of the engineering and chemistry comes into place, because you want to be able to control these interactions from the nanometer scale of receptor ligand interactions and how they're clustered, to the micron scale of a typical mammalian cell, to several hundreds of microns as you would like those cells to assemble and grow into some type of functional tissue-like structure. Not only timescales, but lots of biology acts on many different timescales as well as size scales. And so from fractions of seconds, how cells are signaling to one another, such as calcium transients that occur within a cell, to how proteins are folding and assembling and being secreted into the matrix of a tissue, as well as the lifetime of the cell itself. All right, so there are many different scaffolds one can work with, and I'm not going to go into all of the different material chemistries that one can select, so I'll just introduce you to one type, and that's a hydrogel scaffold here. I'm showing you a macroscopic picture of this hydrogel. If you could see the molecular level details, you'd see long macromolecular chains that would normally dissolve in water, but because of interactions between those chains, it renders them insoluble. And instead, these materials imbibe large amounts of water. And because of this, it imparts many properties that are similar to many of the soft tissues in our body. So some of the challenges and interests are, how can one design materials or these hydrogels where the chemistry can take place in the presence of cells? And here I show some fluorescently labeled cells that can be directly embedded in these hydrogels. And then one can image and watch these cells. And now our questions become, how do I control this hydrogel chemistry to signal to those cells, again, on all those size scales that I mentioned? And then figuring out what are the critical signals and how should they be delivered? And from one perspective, we sometimes think about this and ask ourselves, well, how simple is going to be complex enough to achieve what I'd like? Do I need to recapitulate everything that happens during wound healing when I cut myself, or during the bone healing cascade when I've broken a bone? Or do I need to find the minimal information to reset when I'm delivering those cells so that when I have a critical size bone defect that won't heal, I can intervene in such a way with a simplified mimic that helps bridge that gap and let the body do the rest of the work for us? So those are some of the challenges. So we use these hydrogel scaffolds. And the way we think about this then, in that context, is on the one hand, I might think about designing a hydrogel that's simply permissive to the cells, that the cells can be embedded in this environment. It registers them in three-dimensional space at the density that I would like. Perhaps the cells are getting some physical signals from those mechanosensing type of things. But the cells are going to do the work. They aren't going to receive any type of biological signal per se. But in this environment, the cells can expand, they can secrete, proteins, they can begin to remodel their niche. So that's one way, as a simplified mimic. The other way, sometimes though, depending upon our cells we're working with, we need to create a more promoting environment. So we would like to direct the cells and give them some specific instructions, and it might be as simple as one cue, or it might be a whole series of cues, and it might be cues that need to be presented in different spatial ways or temporal ways. And in this way, we're going to promote them or coax them to do desired functions that we would like. So let's start with the permissive side. So this was some of the work that was starting in the field, and in the last 10 or 15 years, people were very interested in trying to regenerate cartilage. And I'll try to explain why and some of the methods that have worked. All right, so here I'm showing just a picture of a knee joint. Here's your kneecap. On the surface of your knee joint, and all articulating joints, is a cartilage tissue. It allows those joints to move without pain, and it also allows it to move in a smooth fashion and serves sort of as a shock absorber. But if you injure your cartilage tissue has a limited capacity to heal itself. And oftentimes when it's injured, sometimes you'll get some regeneration, but it'll be more of a scar-like cartilage tissue and not the true articulating cartilage. And so what happens is upon injury, and many of you might be interested, I live in Boulder and we ski, so there's lots of interest in cartilage repair and regeneration. But if you have an injury, what leads to is a progressive wearing because you've altered the biomechanics of that tissue, and eventually small defects in your cartilage tissue will wear and erode with time until eventually you'll have bone on bone in this progressive disease. And when you have bone on bone, that's when it leads to lots of pain, and that's at the stage where you would have a total knee replacement, where the ends of your joints would be removed by oscillating saws, and new devices would be put in place, and this articulating joint would be largely made of different types of metal alloys, and that's your new knee joint. And it helps reduce pain, for sure, but one of the problems with that is that it limits some of the activities one can have, and it typically won't last your lifetime if you're younger, or 50 or 60. So a lot of times people wait to have knee replacements until they're much older and their quality of life is reduced in between. So state of the art, about 10, 15 years ago, was using cell-based therapies to try to regenerate and repair cartilage. So the problem is not that you don't have cartilage-forming cells. Lots of us have extra chondrocytes. So one can take a biopsy of your cartilage tissue in sort of a distal region and isolate your own cells. And we have ways that we can expand them in bioreactors. And then they can be delivered back to the patient and delivered back to your defect. And that typically they'll take a little periosteal flap. So that periosteum is tissue covering your bone, and they just suture that over the defect, and that's to hold the cells in place. And this was a great breakthrough at the time. It was one of the first times there was a procedure to remove cells from patients and expand them in large amounts and then redeliver them back to the patient. But the problem is that initially it really only worked well for very small defects, and many patients are going to their surgeons with large surfaces of their cartilage eroded, and you almost need to resurface the joint, and this didn't work so well for that in the beginning. So this is where a lot of biomaterial science came in at that stage, and there was interest in how could we not just deliver the cells, but deliver a biomaterial environment that could be used to resurface or fill a larger defect and signal to those chondrocytes and help coax them to form more cartilaginous tissue. And here's a piece of cartilage tissue. If I were to section it very thin, and then stain it so that you can see it under a light microscope, what you would see are those cells, the chondrocytes. They sort of reside in this lacunae within the tissue, and they have a spherical morphology. And they're responsible for secreting and making the cartilage matrix. So the cartilage matrix has things like these nanofibers of collagen that are very important for the mechanical strength, and their structure and cross-linking is very important for the tissue. And it's a certain type of collagen. Surrounding that network of collagen fibers are these highly branched, you can think of them as highly branched polymer chains. They're really polysaccharides that have these disaccharide repeat units that are negatively charged, and that causes the tissue to imbibe lots of water. So from our perspective, we were thinking this is a lot like a hydrogel material. We have an obvious source of cells. We want to design a matrix for this. So we were thinking of ways to design a delivery system that one could suspend precursors in the presence of cells, inject it into a cartilage defect, and then convert this from a liquid suspension of cells to a solid gel in situ, and then design that gel in such a way that those cells could regenerate the matrix. I'll show you briefly that this is possible. I won't go into the chemistry. You can use lots of different hydrogels for this. Some of the basic building blocks are you have to pick a hydrophilic block to make the hydrogel, and that's PEG. You need to pick a degradable sequence. Short blocks here of polylactide, so short repeating units to make it degradable, physiological pH. And then you need some type of group that's going to allow this to react or interact to form the solid matrix. And here we're putting on reactive end groups that are used in bone cements and dental materials. So one can dissolve this, put it in with chondrocytes, and then do a reaction, a photochemical reaction. So we've heard lots about light interactions with materials. In biomaterials community in this space, we use a lot of light chemistries because one wants to do reactions under the constraints of physiological conditions, 37 degrees C, controlled pH, high amounts of water. So one can optimize all this, and then it becomes all about the structure. How you connected this material, did it self-assemble, what's its structure, and what I'd like to control is I would like to control the water content of the material, the modulus of the material, and a lot of that links to those interactions between the chains and its molecular and nanostructure that I introduce. And they're highly coupled with one another. So as you go to more cross-linked structures that the cells are embedded in, your water content goes down, but your compressive modulus goes up. And you'd like the water content to be high because that influences diffusivity, and the cells are going to make those molecules. But you'd also like it to have mechanical properties around to put this in a weight-loading gel, a weight-loading joint. So I'll just walk through about a couple of students' PhD theses to show you that if you embed these chondrocytes in these material environments, they'll secrete and make these matrix components, and it absolutely couples to the micro and nanostructure of your hydrogel systems. And I can tune that to have one where here I'm staining for that proteoglycan they make. But the trickier part really is that collagen matrix assembly. And collagen within this tissue is several hundreds of nanometers, tens to hundreds of nanometers. And it assembles by this complex process of procollagen molecules being secreted that assemble into these large fibers that need to be cross-linked appropriately. And that's really key to getting the right biomechanics of the tissue. And in these types of systems, it's very difficult to get the collagen to assemble. So here's the cells, and the blue is the collagen. It's all sitting within the lacunae of the cell. And this is all my matrix, or my scaffold, and it can't escape out into this region. And so then that becomes, I need to worry about timescales. Timescales of the cells making the tissues and the timescales of my scaffolding breaking down. And so one can easily engineer these to degrade on different timescales and lose mass as the tissue begins to evolve. And one can create systems where I go from a system that's degrading too slowly to one that eroded too quickly. And I didn't have enough tissue matrix to one that's more optimized. So many different engineering principles can be used here. And then in collaboration with some clinical groups and Jennifer Alisieff, who's a biomedical engineering professor at Hopkins, we translated this through different animal models. And this is a goat's knee joint where we can create a defect in their cartilage, and then we can treat it with our cell-based therapy. And one can optimize and regenerate cartilage in this joint that even begins to recapitulate many of the structural features of native cartilage. So here's the bone, and see some of the organization here. In this environment, when we place our chondrocyte delivery system, we began to see some of the surface structures and some of the columnar organization at the bone. And so I'm not going to go into all of those details, but after about 10 years and some concerted effort, Jennifer and I were involved with a startup company called Cartilex that took this into humans, and it went into clinical trials where about 20 people were tested to repair their knee joints. They're followed by MRI over a year to see what fills they had and regeneration of the cartilage. And then over here is just a measure of mobility for those patients and movement. So what's interesting is that here's a technology where there are many different ways now where we can successfully regenerate cartilage tissue. Some of the problems, though, are that sometimes it's difficult to get the regenerated tissue to integrate with the surrounding tissue, and we need to understand that better. It's also a very expensive procedure, and it's difficult to compete in some of the space with the total hip and knee replacements. So we need to think about different ways and reimbursements for these types of procedures as they evolve. And so then that also brings into another question where, as you have a diverse patient population, this works very well in younger patients, but chondrocytes aren't very active, and it's harder in a more aged population. There can be differences. And how do you design a biomaterial system that's going to work for a broad and diverse range of people? So that brings to some of the ideas and concepts where the field's beginning to go in directions of, can we begin to think about systems where I could either deliver a cell population, perhaps based upon a progenitor cell or an adult stem cell, that I could deliver those cells, and those cells are really giving trophic factors to surrounding cells, and they could help with the regeneration or repair of surrounding tissues. Or could I think about a material itself that I'm only delivering the material, and then I can recruit endogenous cells to this environment and recruit them in such a way that they could regenerate? So this brings us to the point where how do we design hydrogels that can promote healing? And while the permissive gels were good for the chondrocytes, because the chondrocytes are largely in the spherical morphology, many, many cells that you're trying to recruit are anchorage-dependent cells, and they require lots of information from their surrounding environment. And when you put those cells into the matrix, what happens is they're trying to interact with this permissive environment, but they don't recognize any of the chemistry. They're trying to degrade and move through this matrix, but they can't because we have engineered a hydrolysis rate, and it's going to break down at a certain rate, and I don't know what rate the cells would like this to degrade. So that's what, and eventually these cells undergo an anoecus, a programmed cell death because of lack of matrix interactions. So then that takes us in directions in the field where we began to think about how can we begin to more closely mimic aspects of the extracellular matrix that aren't just about physical properties and mechanics and water content and diffusion, but beginning to introduce some of the biology. And when you look at the native extracellular matrix, it has a complex milieu of many different factors, but in a simplified sense, some of the things that the cells get from this environment are their adhesive proteins, where those integrins can bind to and they'll get survival cues. There are linkers here that can be degraded by cell-secreted enzymes, proteases, and they break this down locally in their response to an injury. It's also a reservoir of many different of the growth factors, some of the proteins that Buddy talked about, cytokines and chemokines. But sometimes working with those full proteins can be quite difficult, and we learned about some of those complexities. So some of the field is very interested in bridging synthetic chemistry and material science with protein and natural products found in the body. And one way to mimic or capture some of that is through shorter sequences of the proteins and smaller peptide sequences. And we've learned a lot about different proteins and where cells interact with those proteins and where their active sites are. And we can, in the laboratory and through automated processes, make short sequences of these amino acids. And so we can make this arginine, glycine, aspartic acid that's found in fibronectin that certain integrins will bind with. We know regions found in collagen and other molecules that are sensitive to some of the proteases and will break down when cells secrete those enzymes. And we can also screen through many different peptides that will bind some of those proteins with affinity, so I don't have to conjugate them per se, but they'll be complexed in a way much like they are in the native extracellular matrix. So we and others have been interested in different ways to click together with high affinity synthetic materials with short peptide sequences. And we've done some where this is the amino acid cysteine that has this thiol group. And then we just find different reactive partners to this where these two are completely stable. But when you expose it to light in the presence of an initiator, I can design ways to get these to react very efficiently. And I click together and make hydrogels where now I have a synthetic part and I have a biologic part. And so one can begin to think about controlling physical, mechanical properties through your synthetic chemistry and biological signals just by simply mixing in which signals you'd like to have for these cells. And then one can now look at these movies here. Now, instead of those cells that are anchorage-dependent being immobilized in a matrix, I can design them in such a way that they get the survival cues to adhere, they can locally break down this matrix, and they can migrate throughout, creating localized channels throughout the hydrogel and localized remodeling. And if I make slight changes, I can design systems where certain cells can't migrate through this, but only certain types. So one can begin to think about designing now just materials-based strategies, where here we've made a critical size defect in a rat skull, one that won't heal on its own. And in this craniofacial defect, you're very interested in being able to regenerate bone very quickly if there's been a tumor or been a car accident or have a large loss of bone. And one can insert in just material-based systems designed to recruit endogenous cells and provide a matrix that certain cell types can migrate through. And this was the one that was very slow moving, and you get some mineralized bone regeneration on the periphery. And then over here, you can also have systems where I have very robust regeneration. All materials directed, designed by connectivity and biological functionality to materials. All right, so in my remaining time, what I'd like to do is tell you maybe about some of the future challenges. So I gave some examples where we had an obvious cell source, we could design permissive gels, systems where we wanted to become more biologic and we could design systems to recruit cells locally, but there's lots of advances in the field since those early 2000s to 2010. And where we are today, we're seeing all kinds of advancements in cell sources, from iPS cells to knowledge of more and more adult cells to genetic tools like CRISPR to reprogram cells, that now with some of those advancements, we can begin to think about being able to regenerate nearly any cell type in your body, which opens up areas for nerve repair, regenerating and regrowing maybe functional islets to treat diabetes. We're also having lots of advancements in different types of chemistries, and chemistries that not only recapitulate certain macroscopic properties, but we began to care more and more about from the molecular to the self-assembly at the nano and the structure that's recapitulated in natural tissues, being able to load them up with growth factors in a way that maintains their activity. And also lots of knowledge now that it's not just about the chemistry, but it's also about mechanics in combined ways. And then we have all kinds of ways to process them using top-down and bottom-up approaches. And so this is opening opportunities to begin to think about more challenging problems. And I think in the interest of time, I'm just going to skip to, I'll skip through this example, and I'll talk about some of our interest in working with neurons and trying to understand why we cannot do things like repair a small defect in a spinal cord, or why we can't restore and deliver cells to the brain to treat some of the neurodegenerative diseases. And so I'll give just a little motivation here. So we're learning a lot from the Brain Initiative project. We're mapping out all, not just the functional regions of the brain, but the connectivity of the brain, and we're getting lots of information about this. And even if you aren't trained in this area, I think one can appreciate the major differences in cellularity from a healthy brain versus that from somebody that has Alzheimer's disease. You can see the hippocampus region is very small, an enlargement of the left ventricle. But even as we began to understand this, and we combine this with the idea that we can think about taking iPS cells and being able to differentiate those down neuronal pathways, and not just into neurons, but the whole plethora of the diversity of different types of neuronal cells and the supporting cell structure, there still remains a problem, even if you can get those cells. So here's one example of motor neurons that were differentiated from embryonic stem cells. And they're differentiated into a particular type that, when injected into the spine of a developing, so of a prenatal embryo, here's a mouse embryo, so when it's injected, those cells will integrate. They'll integrate with the developing tissue, and they'll extend axons that will innervate and connect to the musculature, and they'll be very functional. But if you try to do this postnatally, even 5 days, or with adults, and do the same procedure, what happens is those same cells will primarily run rostrocaudally from the head to tail and along the white matter of the spinal cord, and they don't integrate. So even if we have these wonderful cells, we have to find and solve ways to get them to be functional and integrate. And I'll give you one example of what one of the things we've tried to learn. So there have been clinical trials of taking dopaminergic neurons, which are the cells that one loses in Parkinson's disease. And those dopaminergic neurons secrete dopamine that's responsible for our smooth and coordinated movements. And by the time you have Parkinson's disease or the symptoms of it, you've lost somewhere between 90 to 99% of those dopaminergic neurons. But we know where those neurons reside in the brain. So if we could deliver dopaminergic neurons back, would there be some way that we could restore or alleviate that or provide some additional function? But again, in all of the trials that have been done, if you just inject the dopaminergic neurons, at best 10% of those cells survive 1 week after the transplant. It's more typical, only 1% to 2%. So are there ways that one could design a carrier again to promote their survival? But we don't know as much about these cells, and clearly they have complex function. So this is one way that different biomaterials can be useful to try to understand and get information. So we've been interested in designing not only hydrogels that form, but we've designed systems that are light responsive in a way that they can degrade. And we process these. So here's a little linker that when you expose to light, it will cause the hydrogel to fall apart. And we process that into different micro and nano-sized particles that could then be embedded into our cell culture and our neurons that are inside our larger hydrogel construct. And they can be loaded up with all the signals that we're interested in studying. And so here's just a little picture of this. And if you were to take a confocal microscope and its spot size is about this big, so if we click on that image, and so I'm looking at this under my microscope, and then I've slowed this down, so in about 40 seconds I can just degrade those particles and release the contents and then watch how the cells respond to that. So I can learn a lot about which factors influence these cells and influence these dopaminergic neurons. So the experiment is we just watch this under the microscope. And we grow these dopaminergic neurons, and we watch what happens to their survival and their axon growth and what leads to these dense plexus of axons. We can also guide this in different ways spatially. So I can use the laser to address which chemicals, and I can direct even from single cells which way axons form versus this uniform plexus. Or I can even guide a whole direction here. So we're thinking about ways also that neurons can form functional junctions with the musculature. But these are great systems for imaging, and we can watch dynamics of cells. So here, these cells are loaded up with a sensor, that a fluorescent dye that's very sensitive to local calcium levels. So I can begin to understand and look at cell-cell signaling and how a neuron here might extend a signal down its axon and communicate with another cell over in this region. I think our field is going in a direction where we've seen lots of advancements in being able to regenerate and grow tissue structures that largely have a mechanical function, or what we're restoring is their mechanical function. So I think while these cell-based therapies will continue to grow, and we have products with regenerated skin, making bones heal faster, cartilage, even blood vessels. But more complex tissues, and tissues that have a metabolic function, or tissues that have multiple cell types and are integrated, have been much more of a challenge. And we need better strategies, both biologically and materials way, to assemble these. So some of the major challenges are going to be involved not just finding the cell sources and their numbers, but many of those cells, what you do to them when you expand them influences their fate when they're put in the body. So material scientists need to play a role in that. We need to define and achieve functional properties of these tissue equivalents. Do we need to recapitulate everything about the tissue, or can we just restore certain aspects? We need an expanded repertoire of biomaterials, and we need better ways to control many of these properties across size and time scales, and not just the initial material itself, but many times we need to think about these as living material systems and the dynamics of how they can be changed, remodeled, self-healed. And again, that concept of how do we deliver these cues at the right time and place, but maybe even more importantly, how complex do we need to be? So with that, I'd be happy to answer questions, and I thank you all for your attention.